It's September 8th, 1961, and the test airfield in Dunsfold, England is abuzz with anticipation. The Hawker Siddeley P.1127 jet is about to embark on a daring experiment by attempting to perform the world's first vertical takeoff that successfully transitions into horizontal flight before completing its journey with a vertical landing. Years of intense research and development have built up to this moment. Should the P-1127 succeed, it could potentially revolutionize aircraft design and the nature of flight itself. As the crowd of eager engineers, technicians, and military officials look on, the jet's groundbreaking Rolls-Royce Pegasus engine roars to life, its distinctive swiveling nozzles thrusting air downwards to lift the aircraft straight up off the tarmac. As the P-1127 hovers in midair, the tension is palpable. The onlookers wait with bated breath to see if it will be able to transition smoothly into horizontal flight without losing stability or control. Suddenly, the aircraft noses forward, gathering speed as it levels out. Cheers erupt across the airfield, but the test isn't over until the P-1127 shows it can complete the cycle with a vertical landing. As the jet slows down, silence befalls the crowd as they wait to find out if they will indeed witness history in the making. In 1957, a breakthrough conversation took place between jet engine engineer Stanley Hooker of the Bristol Engine Company and aeronautics engineer Sidney Cam of Hawker Aircraft. Hooker revealed that Bristol had been working on an innovative project that fused key elements of their Olympus and Orpheus jet engines to create a directable fan jet engine called Pegasus, following Bristol's tradition of naming engines after characters from classical mythology. A smaller, lighter version of a design originally conceived by French aviation consultant Michel Wibeau, it used a concept known as vectored thrust, in which rotatable cold jets on either side of the compressor would provide the thrust necessary for vertical lift, while a hot jet, directed through a conventional central tailpipe, would allow for horizontal propulsion, thus making to explore the exciting potential of vertical takeoff and landing, or VTOL aircraft, possible. These revolutionary machines promised to eliminate the need for runways by enabling the aircraft to lift off and touch down vertically, rather than the traditional horizontal method. This meant they would require much less space to operate, facilitating flight from reduced areas such as small clearings, urban environments, and ships. In wartime operations, VTOL aircraft could be stationed closer to the front lines, enabling rapid response and making them less vulnerable to enemy attacks on runways. Around the same time, Hawker was looking to replace its Hunter fighter jet and had begun developing a new aircraft known as the P-1121. However, this project was abruptly cancelled following the publication of the 1957 Defense White Paper, which shifted the focus from crewed aircraft to missiles. With the P-1121 project scrapped, Hawker suddenly had resources available for a new venture. Seizing this opportunity, the company turned its attention to the innovative Pegasus engine, exploring its potential for a new military aircraft. This new project aimed to meet an active NATO specification calling for a light tactical support fighter to succeed the Fiat G-91. Hawker's engineers focused on designing an aircraft that would not only incorporate the revolutionary VTOL capabilities of the Pegasus engine, but also meet NATO's stringent performance and load requirements. This decision set the stage for developing a groundbreaking aircraft to redefine military aviation. Ralph Hooper, a senior project engineer at Hawker, immediately got to work designing an aircraft to harness the innovative Pegasus engine using data from Bristol. This design was designated the P-1127. By July, the design included a bifurcated tailpipe with rotatable nozzles for hot and cold exhausts, allowing for a conventional nose wheel led undercarriage, making the aircraft more practical and easier to operate on the ground. Throughout 1958, the design process continued, balancing the need for a lightly armed supersonic fighter with a versatile subsonic aircraft. Extensive physical model tests, including blowing trials to simulate ground effects during takeoff, were crucial in understanding vertical takeoff challenges. This led to the development of a new control response simulator that linked simple flying controls to a computer, allowing engineers to simulate various scenarios and responses without actual flight testing. By late 1958, barely 18 months after the project had begun, all of the P-1127's features, apart from the reaction control system, were finalized. This fast development process was owed not only to NATO's keen interest in the project and the efficient working relationship between Bristol and Hawker, but also to Sidney Cam and his firm belief in design simplicity. Cam explained his philosophy, saying, quote, "Sophistication means complication, then in turn escalation, cancellation, and and finally, ruination. Even major UK defense cuts couldn't slow the project down, as Hawker quickly secured commercial funding, including significant contributions from the US. In April 1959, the development of the reaction control system was complete, and the design was ready. The same month, the Ministry of Supply issued a formal contract for two prototypes. 15 months later, on July 15, 1960, the first P-1127 prototype, serial XP-831, arrived at Dunsfold Aerodrome in Surrey, marking the beginning of a rigorous phase of static engine testing. August 31st witnessed an exciting moment as the Pegasus engine was run for the first time within the airframe, bringing VTOL technology a step closer to reality. A specialized platform was constructed at Dunsfold to support these early hovering trials. This platform was designed to deflect the hot exhaust gases away from the aircraft, ensuring safety while engineers worked on developing more powerful engine versions. By October 13th, they had created a Pegasus capable of generating 11,300 pounds of thrust, and a week later, XP-831 performed its first tethered flight at Dunsfold. However, to do so, the airframe had to be stripped of all extraneous weight, while engine restrictions limited its ability to run at full power to just 2.5 minutes at a time. Tethered testing continued over the next few weeks. On November 4th, XP-831 flew tethered without using its auto-stabilizer system for the first time, and on November 19th, it completed its first untethered free-flight hover. Its maiden conventional flight was performed on February 13th, 1961, shortly before being refitted with an upgraded version of the Pegasus, capable of generating 12,000 pounds of thrust. 4 months later, this engine allowed XP-831 to take another major step forward when it successfully transitioned from vertical hover to horizontal flight, flying the length of Dunsfold's runway at around 165 feet off the ground. Though this was undoubtedly a remarkable achievement, the P-1127 was still yet to reach its ultimate goal, showing that it could not only go from vertical takeoff to horizontal flight, but that it could land vertically afterward as well. In July 1961, testing began on the second prototype, XP-836, beginning with conventional flight. However, on September 8th, it was XP-831 that would be the first to record the groundbreaking feat of vertical landing after vertical takeoff and horizontal flight. To prove it was no one-off, this was repeated several times throughout the rest of the month by both prototypes, including some tests in which the auto-stabilizer was purposely deactivated, validating years of research by demonstrating that VTOL was indeed both feasible and practical. Unfortunately, NATO had by now lost interest in the program. Despite its impressive VTOL capabilities, the P-1127 did not meet their requirements, falling short in key areas such as payload capacity and range. However, the project continued regardless, and in early 1962, the Ministry of Aviation's Operational Requirements Branch approached the Treasury, seeking approval for a batch of 9 production standard aircraft. These aircraft were to be operated by an evaluation unit under the Central Fighter Establishment at RAF West Raynham. With growing interest from the United States and West Germany, the British government seized the opportunity to propose a collaborative effort, inviting these nations to contribute to the project's costs. By May 1962, following the acceptance from all 3 countries, Hawker had received the green light with a formal instruction to proceed, marking the official start of procuring materials for the construction of 9 units of the new aircraft, essentially an upgraded version of the P-1127 called the Kestrel FGA-1. The Kestrel boasted fully swept wings, a larger tail, and a modified fuselage big enough to house the latest version of the Pegasus, now capable of generating up to 15,000 pounds of thrust. It was now aimed to go beyond VTOL to explore the possibilities of performing short takeoffs and landings in situations where runways were of limited length, but not entirely absent. The Tripartite Evaluation Squadron, or TES, was established at RAF West Raynham in October 1964, bringing together an elite team of British, American, and West German military test pilots. Before taking to the skies in the Kestrel, these seasoned aviators underwent a rigorous training regime. A week of ground training at Bristol's facility, another week at Dunsfold, and a 3-hour flight conversion under the expert guidance of Chief Test Pilot Bill Bedford. The squadron's mission was ambitious and critical. They aimed to assess the suitability of vertical short takeoff and landing, or VSTOL aircraft, for field operations, compare various takeoff and landing techniques, develop standard flight operating procedures, perform instrument flight assessments, conduct night flight operations, and explore jetborne maneuvering within the Kestrel's capabilities. This comprehensive evaluation was essential to unlock the full potential of VSTOL technology in real-world military scenarios. During the evaluation, the tripartite pilots established a routine for the Kestrel that involved conducting short takeoffs and returning to base with vertical landings. This approach, known as STOVL, was deemed the most effective practice. The Kestrel also proved its mettle on rough airstrips at nearby RAF Bertram Newton, where it successfully navigated boggy ground and took off from various temporary surfaces. However, the testing was not without mishaps. One aircraft was lost when a pilot attempted a rolling takeoff with the parking brake engaged. Despite this, the evaluations were completed in November 1965. Six of the eight surviving evaluation aircraft were transferred to the United States. There, they were evaluated by the Army, Air Force, and Navy as the XV-6A Kestrel. After the tri-service evaluations, the aircraft were handed over to the USAF for further testing at Edwards Air Force Base, except for two, which were assigned to NASA. The remaining two British-based Kestrels had different fates. One joined the Blind Landing Experimental Unit at RAE Bedford, while the other, XS-693, went to Blackburn for modifications to accommodate the upgraded Pegasus 6 engine, which could generate up to 19,000 pounds of thrust. The P-1127 and Kestrel projects were the stepping stones to one of the most iconic jets in aviation history, the Harrier GR-1. The rigorous testing and evaluation of these early VTOL aircraft laid the groundwork for the development of a more advanced and combat-ready jet. The P-1127's successful demonstration of vertical takeoff, transition to horizontal flight, and vertical landing proved the feasibility of VTOL technology, while the Kestrel's extensive operational trials provided critical insights into the practical applications and challenges of VTOL in a military context. Hawker Siddeley's dedication to refining VTOL technology culminated in the Harrier GR-1, which entered service with the Royal Air Force in 1969. As well as the Pegasus 6, the Harrier incorporated the lessons learned from the earlier projects, featuring enhanced payload capacity, range, and avionics, making it a formidable fighter jet. While the P-1127 and Kestrel may not have become household names, their legacy as trailblazers in VTOL technology endures through the Harrier. The Harrier went on to become one of the most successful and recognizable jets of all time, serving with distinction in numerous conflicts and proving the revolutionary potential of VTOL aircraft, first envisioned many years earlier.